Hi, everybody. Thank you for that generous introduction, Jarnita, and thanks to everyone for making this conference possible. It's been fantastic so far. I know I've heard such great things about all of the various panels. Andres Serrano's bio is in the book as well as on the conference website, so I'm going to give a little more personal introduction to the artist. In February 2013, during an especially challenging time at El Museo del Barrio, facing financial and administrative challenges, imagine that, a small arts organization, I organized an exhibition titled Super Real, or Super Real, Alternative Realities in Photography and New Media. This exhibition drew on the museum's permanent collection of video and photography and incorporated the work of other Latinx artists with those of, the idea was to combine the work of established artists with those of lesser known, and in some cases, unknown artists. We literally had objects in the collection that came into the collection without a known artist attached to them. I remember being worried at the time that it might be difficult to borrow works from some of the more established artists like our next speaker. His large-scale photograph of a small white figurine of Moses submerged in a shimmering bath of golden liquid, a bodily fluid, was installed between two large-scale black and white photographs by the New Yorican photographer Sophie Rivera. It was an exceptional wall of portraits. He was often an important presence at El Museo. His work and the activism he has engaged in through his photography over five decades have made him a crucial figure in the history of American art. At the height of the so-called age of multiculturalism, Andres Serrano's work also played a significant part in the culture wars of the 1990s. That war saw, among other tragedies, the permanent ending of grants to individual artists from the National Endowment for the Arts, and preceded many other controversies at museums across the country. These kinds of attacks on freedom of expression and individual artists continue to this day. We're still in the midst of a war on culture. Artists of color continue to be excluded from museum collections, exhibitions, and publications. This is fact, backed up by data. Our support for artists of color and the organizations that represent them continues to be crucial. The expansion of the American cultural canon towards racial equity has to remain a top priority. Born in 1950 in New York City, Andres Serrano attended the Brooklyn Museum School, where he studied painting and sculpture. His work is represented in numerous major public and private collections and has been shown in exhibitions all over the world. I'm grateful to Andres for his bravery and his generosity. Throughout his career, he has continually shown his deep and abiding respect for his subjects, from the homeless to the deceased, through his carefully considered images. To touch on the AIDS pandemic, he created images of blood and semen. To give honor and respect, he created regal images of Native Americans and regular folks with the symbolic material of their vocations. All of this steeped in the beautiful drama of the Baroque. His kind and gracious response to our invitation to speak today marks him once again as a great supporter of the arts and serves to reinvigorate us in our work. Please help me welcome Andres Serrano.
So I looked at some of the videos of the previous keynote speakers, and they seem to be high-minded people of noble intent. Unfortunately, I'm not that guy. I don't wake up in the morning thinking, how can I make this world a better place? But, so the only thing that I'm qualified to speak about, it's what it's like to be an artist, this artist. As Rocio said, I was born in Manhattan. I'm a New Yorker, I've been a New Yorker all my life, meaning as much as I've traveled, New York has always, I've always had a home in New York. growing up, I grew up in Williamsburg because when I was about 7 years old, My grandmother got a brownstone in Williamsburg. And so the family moved there, meaning the family, meaning my grandmother and my cousin, who was a little older than me, not about 7 years older than me. They lived on the ground floor, and my mother and I lived on the second floor. I was raised by my mother. I was an only child because my father left us when I was very young. And frankly, I've always said I couldn't blame him because, you know, it was tough to live with my mother. As an only child, no husband, you know, there were a lot of demands and made on me. You countered with a lot of love, but sometimes too much love. So my mother and I would fight a lot every day, you know, and we would scream at each other. Now, I nowadays you say, oh, there was verbal abuse in the family, you know, but I didn't see it as abuse of any kind. I saw it as boot camp, you know. It was good training because my mother was vicious, so I had to be as good or better than her. But one time, my mother said something to me that really knocked me out. I was at a loss for words. And what she said was, "Me cago en la madre que te parió," which means, "I shit on the mother who gave birth to you." I had to burst out laughing because there was nothing I could say, you know? I gotta say, that day she came up with a good one. I gotta give it to her. She won that round. But as much as I hated my mother, I also loved my mother. And I know I loved her because you know, one time in the eighth grade, I was about to receive a medal in composition for graduation. And about 2 weeks before graduation, my mother got sick. And she had a nervous breakdown. My mother had been having nervous breakdowns throughout my childhood. And they were very specific. They would last a week to 10 days, and then within 2 weeks, she'd be back to normal. So I learned to tell the signs. I could see the signs of when she was gonna have one, you know? Acting a little funny one day, the next day, I knew she'd be off a rocker. So, you know, this time, she got sick, and as I had to do, I would stay home, because otherwise, she would follow me to school. It would be embarrassing, you know. I didn't want people to know my mother was not well. And so this time, you know, I stayed home and for about a week. And then I felt it was okay to go back to school now. So I had my cousin write me a letter, an excuse, excusing me, I was sick at home. Unfortunately, I left the house prematurely, and that day my mother showed up in class and starts talking, and you know, she didn't speak much English, but she knew enough to cause trouble, and she starts talking to the teacher, and they find out that letter is she didn't write that letter. So the next day, I remember going to school, I was a little bit late, and as I'm going in the door, my teacher and the principal happened to be there. And they gave me, you know, they chewed me out for the letter. And then the principal said, "And you know that medal of English, for English you were going to get, forget about that." So, you know, as much as I hated my mother, I would never let a stranger know my mother's business. As far as I was concerned, her business was her business. And so, you know, I took it like a man and said, okay. So I know that was a moment of love where I had to sacrifice something for her because she was my mother. Now, after grade school, I went to boys high. You know, grade school for me was going to school with the same bunch of kids for several years, from the fourth grade through the eighth grade. And it was an Italian neighborhood. We lived on the Italian neighborhood side of Williamsburg. A few blocks up was the Puerto Rican side, and then a few blocks later was the Orthodox community. But I was on the Italian side, and so the kids I went to school with were all Italians. And when I got to Boys High, and back then it was Boys High, not Boys and Girls High, it was a school in Bed-Stuy, and it was all black, and I didn't know anybody. It was 90%, 99, 95% black. And I didn't feel connected to the kids there, and so after 1 year, I dropped out of school. And I didn't go back to school till 2 years later. I was now 17, when I got a scholarship at the Brooklyn Museum Art School, and so, you know, I felt at home there. So as Rocio said, I went there for 2 years, and I studied painting and sculpture. Now, I was born to be an artist, and the reason I say that is because I couldn't do anything else. I mean, I didn't try to do anything else. I mean, the only thing I really wanted to be was a rock star, but learning to sing, having a band, learning music, it was too much trouble. So I did what came natural and started making art. I mean, for me, I didn't need to practice for that. But after 2 years of art school, when it was over, I went into the real world. And one of the places where eventually I wound up was in the Lower East Side at the age of 21, I believe. And there, you know, I did something that was in 1971. It was something that was happening everywhere, but particularly in the East Village. And that was, there was a drug life. And I went right into the drug life. And for 7, 8 years, I took drugs and I sold drugs, mostly pot and pills. But that was my lifestyle. And a good friend of mine, once called me an artist, and I said, Michael, don't call me an artist. I'm not an artist right now. I'm a drug dealer and I'm a drug addict, you know? So I felt like there was a part of me that understood I couldn't serve two masters at once. And my drug addiction prevented me from even aspiring or wanting to call myself an artist. So, now at the age of 28, 1978, I'm pushing 30, and I decided, I said to myself, I always said I was gonna be an artist, and if I continue in this lifestyle on drugs, you know, I'll never become the artist I wanna be. And so then I did something that was probably the most difficult thing for me to ever do. I weaned myself off of methadone. Methadone was the hardest drug I ever endured. And it took me a good year to get off methadone, meaning going from 100 milligrams down to 50, 20, 10, 5. Finally, you know, 1%, one milligram. But once I got off it, I had a lot of energy and I couldn't sleep at night. So I started going out to clubs. And one day in a club, I met a woman by the name of Julie Ault. And Julie was with a bunch of friends. I said hello to them. But Julie and I were on the dance floor and we danced. And I never really talked to her friends. I later found out that Julie had just formed this group called Group Material with Tim Rollins and a bunch of other of her friends. And it was an artist organization that addressed social issues such as AIDS and, you know, consumerism, the war in Central America, all kinds of things. And their thing as artists, they were artists, but they used other people's, other artists' work to do exhibitions. Through Julie, the first time I saw Jenny Holzer's work and many other artists was when they were asked to be part of group material exhibitions. I remember the first things I ever saw by Jenny Holzer, they were pieces of paper with words on them. I mean, artists, they have no money, they have to make work accordingly. When you get more money, you can make bigger pieces, but when you have no money, but ideas, you have to find a way to make what art. But also, another person that I met through Julie was Felix Gonzalez Torres. And Felix, I mean, Julie did not discover Felix. But I credit Julie with being one of the first people in the art world in New York City to recognize Felix's talent. And so she asked him to become part of group material. I was not part of group material. They had weekly meetings, and you know, even though they used my work from time to time in one of their shows, I was never a part of it because I can't be a part of any kind of group. You know, I got to do my own thing. And so it was a good thing we had separate lives, you know. She had group material and I started to do my work. So had I gone from art school to making art, I probably would have made something else. And like I said before about boot camp training with my mother, everything that happens to you as an artist is fuel for inspiration. Everything, you know, you use it in some way, consciously or unconsciously. And I think my mother, my experiences on the street made me a certain type of artist with a kind of hard edge, you know. I was born angry, I think. You know, probably that anger, you know, I was able to channel it toward my mother, but later on toward the world, in my art. And I think anger is one of those very useful tools for an artist. Artists have a lot of tools. Anger is one of them. I mean, when I look at the work of certain artists, Francis Bacon, for example, I see anger. When I see the work of Jackson Pollock, I see a lot of anger, you know? I see Jackson Pollock attacking the canvas like it was his enemy. Motherfucker, you know? You don't want to give me a show? I'll show you, fucking idiot, you know? Elaine, dear, are you in your studio? The only thing I like more than painting is booze. Elaine, can you get me a beer, would you? I think anger is a good thing. The other thing that is a good thing is ego. Kanye West has said that he is the best artist ever in history, ever. Now, I've never heard a Kanye West song, so I don't know if he's right or wrong. I can't call him out on that. But I remember that I had photographed Arthur Miller from my America series, which I'll show you some images from the America series later. And so when Arthur Miller died, my wife Irina and I, we were invited to his memorial service at the Majestic Theater on Broadway. And I remember that Edward Albee got up on stage and said, "Now that Arthur Miller is dead, I am the greatest living American playwright." And I thought, wow, that's cool. He's being honest, you know? I mean, whether or not you believe him, he believes it. And so I thank him for his honesty. Gore Vidal, he was another one. He was great. Gore Vidal said, "It's not enough to succeed. Others must fail." Okay? So artists, or many artists, are full of honesty. It's a great trait to have, honesty. And also ego. You know, ego, I don't know if ego is a bad word nowadays. You know, I don't know if it's politically correct to think you're the best artist in the world, but many do. You know, they keep it to themselves. Michelangelo, we take Michelangelo. Michelangelo didn't try to be small. He wasn't thinking small. He was thinking big. And that's why Michelangelo's work has so much power. The funny thing about Michelangelo is that he considered himself a sculptor, and to him, painting was below him. And yet he painted the Sistine Chapel. That's incredible. Now, one of the things that artists do is they work hard, really hard, to bring you your art. You know, and you don't know some of the shit that artists go through. They're always fighting with money, with other people, but especially with themselves. There's always that turmoil and conflict. And they have to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune to bring you your art. It's like you go to the restaurant, you say, what do you want? What do you want? I want a steak, medium rare. Okay, let me go out and kill that cow for you, all right? Let me go slaughter that beast and cook it for you so that you don't have to get your hands dirty. And they come back with the art, and they say, okay, and he says to you, okay, here's your art. There's some salt on the table if you want to put it on the art. You know, artists have to endure a lot and struggle a lot. Some of the best known artists have had monumental struggles and obstacles to overcome. Rembrandt saw a lot of success in his life. But as he got older, he made a lot of money, but he spent a lot of money. He spent a lot of money on art, alimonies, all kinds of things. In the end, Rembrandt lost his house, and he died broke. Can you imagine that? He died broke. Vincent van Gogh, we know what he did with his money. He didn't do anything with his money because he didn't make money. He sold one painting for 400 francs. Thanks to his brother Theo, who is an art dealer and supported him, Gauguin had that encouragement and also the funds to be able to continue. Meanwhile, Theo was selling other people's work. Degas, all the Impressionists. He could sell everyone's work except his brother's work. Nobody wanted that shit, okay? One of the greatest folk artists ever, Bill Traylor, was born into slavery and was a sharecropper all his life until he turned 85. And then he started painting. And you know, Bill, he painted and drew on whatever he could, cardboard, whatever. Fortunately, a guy named Charles Shannon, a young white kid artist, he saw Bill, who was at the time living in the back of a funeral parlor, in the back room of a funeral parlor. He saw Bill on the street doing his thing, and he decided, I gotta help this man. I like what he's doing, I gotta help him. And so Charles started giving him materials. And it was thanks to Charles that Bill was able to make his work and have a show. Before he died, he had a show. And it was an impressive show. In fact, it was so impressive that Alfred Barr, who was then the director of MoMA, he wanted to buy some of Bill's work. He said, yeah, I'm gonna give you a dollar a piece. Actually, sometimes I'll give you two, but I'll give you between $1 and $2 a piece for the work. The sale didn't go through. Today, Bill Traylor's work goes for $500,000 and more. He's a genius. And if not for Charles Shannon, Bill's work could have wound up in the garbage. There are probably a lot of artists we don't even know about whose work went right to the dumpster because nobody appreciated it when they died. Nobody knew what this is. What is this? It went straight to the garbage. So artists have always depended on the kindness of strangers. I know I have. I've gotten several grants, including the NEA grant that was so controversial, and every bit helped. I remember one, I've made big paychecks, but I remember this one time I made some money, and it will always stick to me because I didn't really make it. And it was after I had gotten off drugs, and I was literally had no money in my pocket, and I'm walking around in the rain, and I see a $20 bill on the street. I mean, to me, God sent me that $20 because he knew I needed it. And that's what artists, they're always happy and grateful to get what they need when they need it. Because as I said, artists spend a lot of money. The more money you make, the more you spend. And a lot of times, you're spending it on making more work. Because things, you have more ideas, bigger ideas. And so you spend a lot of your income on just making work. And then the work doesn't always sell. So there's that balance. So this myth of the struggling artist is no myth. Artists struggle at every point in their lives, mentally, physically, and financially. As I said, I've been lucky that I've gotten several grants, but I feel that, what I want to say is, I'm not a political person. At least I'm not a political artist. In fact, I think of myself as being apolitical. There's an organization called Apolitical that thankfully has helped me do several projects in the last few years. And I needed that support in order to realize these projects. But having said I'm not a political artist, I got eyes and I see things. And I may not express it in my work, but I'm thinking about it. And one of the things that I've been thinking about for several years is those kids, those Mexican children and Hispanic children who were put in cages. And what I see is this: if they were black children, if they were white children, if they were green children from Mars, that would never have happened. But they were Mexicans and Hispanics. And so the immigration people were told, don't worry about it. There's no legal or moral standing here. Do whatever you need to do to get these kids away from their parents and put them in cages. And when it gets cold, don't worry about it. We got tin foil. We got a contractor who's going to sell us all the tin foil we need. So don't give a thought about these children. They're not children. Think of them as just animals. Now, Donald Trump and Melania Trump caused a lot of confusion over the years because everybody was wondering, what did they mean? What did Donald Trump mean by that? What did Melania Trump mean when she went down to this immigration center to see children in Texas and she wore that jacket that said, I don't really care, do you? Well, in case you don't know what it meant, I'll tell you what it meant. She was saying to the Trump supporters, she's saying, listen, I gotta go down there for this photo op, but you know I don't give a shit about them kids, okay? That's what she was saying. Things are sometimes so obvious that it goes over people's heads. And the smarter people are, the dumber they are sometimes, because I'm thinking now about Donald Trump. They spent a lot of time trying to analyze what Donald Trump was saying or doing, and he told you straight out. Donald Trump, not only is he not a liar, except when he wants to lie, when he wants to tell the truth, that is to say, to your face, he will tell you. He has no qualms about telling you what he thinks of you. That is, an asset for Donald Trump. He loves to tell you what he thinks of you. And usually, Mostly, he doesn't think much of you, no matter who you are. Now, America has always been a mighty power. And sometimes the country needs to show that power. They have to flex their muscles. But they can't, they have to decide who to get tough with and who they can't get tough with. Now, when President Biden went to visit the Crown Prince in Saudi Arabia, he was told by his advisors, Mr. President, remember, you're only there for the oil, okay? Don't talk about the murder, don't talk about the human rights, don't talk about nothing except the oil. Focus on the oil. And the prince, the Crown Prince, he knew exactly, before Biden got there, he knew exactly what the deal was. He knew that he, the prince, had the upper hand because Biden went to him. He didn't come to Biden. And so, you know, the Crown Prince, he listened to the president. He said, okay, son, let me think about that, okay? I got a lot of things on my plate, and I got to, you know, so let me think about how much oil I can give you and when. I'll get back to you on that. With Putin, advisor said, you know, you cannot fuck with Putin. He is crazy. He's got nukes. He can nuke us. So don't fuck with him, okay? You know, try to be cool and treat him with kid gloves, but don't fuck with him. Don't make him too mad. So the administration says, but you know what? We got to get tough on somebody. Otherwise, we look weak. So who can we fuck with, all right? I got it. Cuba. Ah, Cuba. Those people, even though Castro has been dead for a long time, even though Castro left office in 2008, those are the people we have to punish because they are America's number one enemy. And why do we say this? Because they have no money, they got no nukes, and they got nothing we want. What, they got sugar, Cuban cigars? We don't need that. So, Mr. President, now, Cuba has had that embargo for 60 years now. I propose an amendment that we extend the embargo for another 100 years. All ayes, everyone vote, all ayes say aye, and it goes, it's unanimous. Okay, we extend the boycott for another, the embargo for another 100 years. You know, you have to know who to fuck with. And America likes to fuck with the people who are defenseless. I'm not going to get into race, but we know where race is in this country. And you know where it started. It started when the Europeans came over here and thought they could take over this place because the people who were here, they weren't going to build it up the way they could. And so they took the land. They took the land and they made it theirs. And in order to cultivate the land, at some point they said, we need slaves. We got to bring some slaves here, okay? And that's what they did. Now, the Civil War has been over for 100 years, more than 100 years. But has it really? The red states are still acting like they hate the blue states, you know? And the red states, who don't make the kind of money the blue states make, you know, still they want their share of the money, of the pot. You know, when it comes to supporting the blue states, they don't want money to go there. Miami, you know, that governor, he didn't want the people in New Jersey to get money for for Sandy. But then when Florida gets hit with a hurricane, He wants the money. He wants that federal cash, all right? So the great hypocrisy is that the United States is not united, you know? And Donald Trump, he understood that. Donald Trump did not create that division. Donald Trump profited by it. He used it. He told these people, listen, I know how you feel about those people, and you should, because they're not like you. So you have every right to feel the way you do. American artists, you know, are something else. They are usually on the right side of history, but there's also division within art. I mean, a lot of people don't know what art is. For many people, art is something that's either in a museum or something that has is in a gallery that costs a lot of money. If it doesn't cost a lot of money, it must not be very good. So the public oftentimes is confused about what art is. And because of that, many artists are constantly struggling. The arts need support from people who have the money to support the arts. And when I say the arts, I'm not talking about only artists. I call anybody who's creative an artist. Music, plays, films, everything. If you are creative, you're an artist. And so artists are always in constant need of money and support. Now, I don't know how many of you out there have money to give, but I think that, but that's the whole thing, the whole point with Grantmakers in America is to find the people who are willing to support the arts. I've always supported the arts, even when I couldn't afford it, because I have no choice but to be an artist. And I think a lot of artists are in the same boat. They don't know, or they don't want to do anything else. And it's not easy being an artist, you know. It's not easy living in your head 24 hours a day. But you have to, because there's no time off of being an artist. You can't say, well, I'm not going to think about art. Even if you're not making it, you're thinking about it. You're being, and you're not only thinking about it, you're being shaped. You're being pulled in many different ways by the things you see around you. Now, I'm just going to show you a few of my slides so that you see what the work does. And after that, I am going to show 3 minutes of a film that I made called Insurrection, which is about the insurrection. So this is my work. This is called Blood. At some point, I started to make work that was, for me, very different. It refers to painting, and it's very abstract. There's no spatial relationship. There's no model. There's only color. Milk Blood was the first one before, and Milk Blood referred to Mondrian, and there's Blood. There's Blood, which is the first monochrome that I've ever seen in photography. This is Milk. It's also a monochrome. And my printer once said to me, this is the most unusual picture I ever had to print. Can't we just use the paper, the white paper? And I said, no, you gotta print the picture. Black Jesus, female bust. This is one of the immersions where I started to use piss as one of the tools in my arsenal, one of my colors in my palette. I've always said my work is open to interpretation. So when I take pictures, I take them without judgment. And I'm always happy and grateful for the people who pose for me, whether or not I agree with their lifestyle choices. There's a Klanswoman. This is from the America series, which I did started shortly after 9/11, and this is a firefighter. This is another firefighter that had been digging through the rubble at the World Trade Center when I photographed them. They came to the studio. This is J.B. Pimp, because he, to me, is what America is all about. And of course, the greatest, one of the greatest pimps ever, Donald Trump. I took this picture in 2003. This is a picture I'm very proud of because Metallica used it for one of their covers, Load. And this is a Mickey Mouse robot from my latest series. So that's all the work I want to show you. But I want to leave you with 3 minutes of insurrection. We haven't found a distributor, but the film has been shown in a couple of places. Tomorrow we go to the Atlanta Museum to show it, and next month it will be shown at the Florence Film Festival. It will open the festival. So I'm going to say thank you and just leave you with the clip.
There's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say, there ain't no doubt I love this land.